Welcome back to Game Versus Game. I'm Eric, and this episode has been a long time coming, so let's get right into it. It's time for Rayman 2.
Oh my god. He's finally doing it. Dude, it's about freaking time. Like, I've been waiting for you to do a remake or it's a different channel. It's been so long, I don't even remember what your freaking channel's called. It's been so long, I was practically gonna, like, do this for you, but I'll leave a master to his craft.
Rayman was initially released in 1995 for the PS1 and eventually made it to tons of other platforms like the Saturn, the Jaguar, DOS, Game Boy Color, and Game Boy Advance to name a few, even making the cut for the ill-fated PlayStation Classic. It was your classic 2D platformer formula, it was met with very positive reviews, so work on a sequel was inevitable.
Rayman 2 The Great Escape began its life following in its predecessor's footsteps as a 2D platformer, but with 3D becoming more and more prominent, it was eventually reimagined as a 3D platformer.
Rayman and his friends are beset by Razorbeard and his robo-pirates. They shatter the heart of the world, scatter its pieces, and capture Rayman. Once free, Rayman embarks on his journey to defeat Razorbeard and his pirates for good by returning the four masks to free the god Polycus.
Also, like the first one, Rayman 2 was released to a ton of systems,
starting with the N64 and PC on October 31st, 1999. It was then released for the Dreamcast on February 9th, 2000, then to the PS1, September 16th of the same year. The game then got a huge renovation and released on PS2 as Rayman 2 Revolution, also known as Rayman Revolution in other countries, on January 31st, 2001. In June that same year, the Game Boy Color saw a release as well. And then finally, the N64 was ported to the Nintendo DS as Rayman DS, March 24th, 2005, and the Dreamcast version ported to the 3DS as Rayman 3D, March 22nd, 2011.
That is a lot, and kind of a mess, but it's exactly this mess that we're here to talk about today. To get started, it would be good to know what we're actually dealing with, because there's seven games to contend with.
Two of them, Rayman DS and Rayman 3D, are direct ports of the N64 and Dreamcast respectively. Then there's Rayman 2 Forever for the Game Boy Color, which really is its own thing, connected to the others in theme and story only. We can set these three aside for later, which leaves us with the N64/PC, which I'm lumping together because they were the original versions in development together. The Dreamcast, which the guy that I got my copy from on eBay would definitely say it's the best version, having sent this note along with it. The PS1, finally, the PS2.
So with our course set, let's get into all of this. First, let's talk graphics really quick, because there's not really miles between each of these games, even with the generation jumps.
The Dreamcast is the standout here, with cleaner and higher resolution textures. Not to mention, it's gorgeously smooth animation. Even the PS2 doesn't quite live up to the Dreamcast with its less stable frame rate, even though it does render some previously 2D textures as 3D modeled elements like the climbing vines here.
Beyond that, it's really just what you'd expect from each of these platforms, like the N64 and PS1 look a little more jagged than the others. But really, there's not much to complain about with any of them visually. Once you get into the actual meat of the game, though, that's a different story, as each one introduces its own take on the N64 and PC standard. Some for the better, others not so much. But let's start at the beginning.
Rayman's captured, imprisoned by Razorbeard, and helpless. His good friend Glowbox is captured as well and brings a silver lump for Rayman, restoring some of his powers. It's here that the games begin to diverge already. The N64, Dreamcast, and PS1 games all start the same, with Rayman receiving the ability to shoot energy from his fist. On the PS2, however, he only gains the ability to punch, and doesn't receive the shooting ability until you complete the intro stage and meet the Teensy King. The introductory level tasks you with collecting 5 yellow lums, or 10 in the PS1 version, in order to proceed. You'll also encounter the first cages in the game, and get to talk with various characters, which are all very different things in each game. So, let's start with the lums. You're told that the Lums are pieces of the heart of the world that Razorbeard and his crew destroyed and scattered. It's your job to collect them, and in fact, you have to collect enough by certain points in the game in order to proceed.
As I just mentioned, even in the intro stage, there's a different amount per game. Well, at least for the PS1, but that might be just because it has only 800 instead of 1,000. Well, 999, because at some point, Razorbeard eats a yellow Lum, reducing the total from 1,000 to 999. And in the PS1, he eats a red Lum instead of a yellow Lum, so it doesn't reduce it, and, well, actually, the PS2 gives you the 1,000th Lum back when you rescue Clark, and actually, further to that point, you can find a secret Lum in the other games, so it's back to 1,000 all around, except for the PS1.
The yellow Lums are clearly important in the game, but they actually play an even more critical role in the PS2 game because they act as currency to purchase new and enhanced abilities for Rayman. Powers that you would normally gain throughout the game, like the charge shot, or have from the get-go, like the fact that your regular shot bounces, and even some new ones, like being able to move faster while carrying things, you can purchase and upgrade at your own pace in Revolution. That's the yellow Lums, at least. There's also green Lums, which are your checkpoints, and red and blue Lums, which restore your health and air meters, respectively. The only difference here is that you cannot collect red Lums on the Dreamcast when your health is already at maximum, and that the blue Lums don't actually exist in the PS2 version at all. Instead, they're replaced with air bubbles coming out of the ground, which is honestly a pretty weird change to have made. Like, why add this element of realism?
A glowing blue orb that helps you hold your breath longer? Sure, whatever. But bubbles? His head's not even connected. How's air getting to his lungs? Does he even have lungs? What are you, Rayman?
Circling back to the cages and what's in them, on the N64 at least, you'll find mostly yellow Lums, with the final cage in each stage holding a Teensy, who opens the door to leave, and destroying 10 cages will increase your maximum health slightly. This is the same approach that the Dreamcast took. The PS1 version went in a different direction, instead replacing the Lums with one of three species, and freeing any of them now increases your max health, which, as you can imagine, nets you a very long life bar by the end. The PS2 goes in yet another direction, and sort of combining the two. The cages here now contain familiars, which don't do anything on their own, but freeing 10 of them will provide access to a new challenge from Lee, which if successfully completed will increase your maximum health. Basically, cages mean more health. It just varies between each game and how it's implemented.
Have you noticed that we're not even out of the first level yet? Well, lastly, between the introduction and intro level, you may have noticed one of two things. One, that Rayman Gibber's language is super cool, especially that Murphy. Or two, I thought Rayman and everyone talked in some sort of weird gibberish language. So here's the deal. Yes, Rayman 2 was originally shipped with a spoken dialogue, but that dialogue was recorded in incomprehensible gibberish, or Raymanese, both to save money in dubbing in various languages, and to make the game more universal, and it worked! It's a charming touch, and in my opinion, is part of what the Rayman world is.
The PS1 went and changed that by dubbing everything in English, French, and Spanish. No gibberish whatsoever. At least the English dub is done pretty well, even though it does hit the cheese factor a few times.
Oh, Rayman, at last. I was afraid Globox had failed.
He gave me the silver Lum, but we got separated.
The downside of this, though, is that it's really lacking the charm that the gibberish brought, and it's sorely missed here. Thankfully, the PS2 offers an option to change the language to Raymanian, which restores the gibberish language of the original. It also offers a German language option in place of from the PS1. And this isn't just lifted files from the PS1 dub, no. The English version, at least, has been completely redubbed.
Oh, Rayman, at last. I was afraid Globox had failed.
He gave me the silver Lum, but we got separated.
At first, I immediately switched over to gibberish, but every time the game's turned off, it resets to the default selection of English, and to be honest, eventually I just gave up trying to switch.
So, you've finished the intro level, the Teensy King opens the portal, Rayman jumps in, and everything's different again already.
On the N64, this introduces you to the Hall of Doors. Oh, right, full disclosure, these portals are all called doors. but they describe much better as portals, which is kind of how I'll be referring to them. Anyway, the Hall of Doors is sort of a featureless void, with just a series of these portals granting access to each open stage. And you can backtrack to any previously visited stage to replay it looking for more lums, cages, or other secrets. Pretty standard fare as overworld maps go, actually. The Dreamcast expanded this concept, creating the Isle of Doors, which fleshes out the N64's sparse void, with colorful visuals and exaggerated set pieces from the levels. The functionality is exactly the same, with the annoying habit of fading out the area name so you've got to keep bringing it back up. But with that aside, it creates a more immersive world, rather than presenting that Rayman navigates the ether to travel between areas. On PS1, it actually brings back to the Hall of Doors, just like the N64, with two exceptions. One, some portals have been relocated, most notably the Cave of Bad Dreams, which is accessed through the Marshes of Awakening in all of the other versions, now has its own portal right next to Menhir Hills. And two, Rayman doesn't automatically move to the newly opened portal after completing a stage, which seems minor, but for some reason is really irritating. As for Revolution, it's in its own category altogether, because instead of dropping you into an overworld map, it drops you into a completely new hub world. It starts you out with some basic tutorials, which is a little tedious, but then gives you free rein to go wherever you're able to get to. Ultimately, the hub is broken into three main sections with Stonehenge-like rings, with portals to each of the levels that you've completed. Explore further, and you'll find lums, enemies, and a few secrets around too. Not to mention the magic well where you can upgrade Rayman's abilities. This hub world makes the world of Rayman Revolution feel much more connected and intentional. Big win for the PS2 here. Now's when the game really opens up. You're out of everything that could be called introductory or tutorial and into the first main level, and you can get a real sense of how the game controls and especially how the camera reacts, which, just let me say, the auto camera on PS2 gets into some really awkward spots that the others never seem to struggle with. Some of it was intentional, I think, to create more dynamic angles and areas, but this thing can get infuriating. You'll also notice between the levels, each game looks a bit different, which I'm not going to itemize every single discrepancy between these, like that the Dreamcast version has a gap here. In fact, we're just going to talk in broad strokes about the level structures as a whole, and which platforms did what. For example, let's talk about the Dreamcast for a second and the gap in the Fairy Glade. It's actually kind of indicative of the kind of alterations that it implemented, very minor ones. You won't see many structural changes or missing or new sections here. This game instead introduces its level variability through enemy placement. There's a lot more hidden enemies that'll pop out of the ground to fight, usually in more secluded or secret, non-required areas like the back corridor beneath the Sanctuary of Rock and Lava.
They're not exclusively in those areas, but more often than not, if you're in an optional area with only lums or cages, ground guy's coming for you.
As for the PS1, I've already mentioned some things have been redesigned, like the entrance to the Cave of Bad Dreams from the Marshes of Awakening, and there is more of that. Like, for example, in the Iron Mountains, instead of rescuing Uglet's kids by flying around to each of the mines, you free them from the pen area when you're on the rocket above the pirate hideout. Incidentally, the chicken robot's penned up in there now too, instead of already rampaging around outside, and once the gates open, it falls over, and you get to hear Razorbeard's assistant swear.
I forgot to fill the tank.
There's quite a few changes like this throughout the PS1 game to reduce the level's sizes almost across the board. The PS2, as you might expect by now, is very different, with new areas and challenges like this Space Invaders-style gauntlet, or like destroying two generators located in new areas within the precipice and echoing caves in order to disable an electric fence to access the factory. All brand new. Most importantly, though, Revolution is bursting with boss fights, introducing three new ones. The first replaces the new henchman fight in the canopy with an actual pirate ship. There's also Biddy Tank in the factory and a new fourth guardian, Grolem 13, who guards the fourth mask. Which, if you know the game, you might be saying to yourself, I thought you got the fourth mask from rescuing Uglet's kids from the mines. Well, in the N64 and Dreamcast games, yes, and you do still get the mask from the kids in the PS1 version just by rescuing them from the chicken bot, as I mentioned. In Revolution, rescuing the kids from the mines now grants Rayman the Rain Dance mask, which allows Rayman to do Glowbox's Rain Dance to gain access to previously inaccessible areas.
Now back to bosses for a minute, because we've really got to talk about that final battle with Razorbeard and the Grolgoth.
All four versions start with the same first phase. A battle atop the crow's nest with Glowbox dangling over the edge and Rayman facing down the Grolgoth all by himself. After three successful hits, he'll destroy the mesh floor and you both fall down. You'll get a rocket and begin the second phase, and it's here that things get interesting. For the N64, Dreamcast, and PS2 versions, You have the same phase 2, with one slight variation. You're in a circular room with lava below you, and two tunnels running off of it. You've got to travel down one of them to collect the energy ball to attack the Grolgoth, who's perched in the main room between two pillars. He'll soon start sending homing missiles after you, and then start raising the lava to trap you in the tunnels.
Now, I don't know if I just got lucky, but in my experience, the lava level was never raised while I was playing the Dreamcast version. As for the PS1, you've got an entirely new fight. This time, an on-rails shooter.
Razorbeard will shoot, throw explosives, and drop mines to try to stop you, but no matter. This is a much easier fight than the other versions. Just keep dodging and shooting, and you're good.
Now that you're in the endgame, you're free to go back and replay levels. Find all the secrets that you missed, and unlock all the bonuses that each game has to offer.
Well, spoiler, the N64 doesn't have any, but the Dreamcast introduced 6 Glowbox crystals hidden throughout the game, which you can trade in at a hidden Glowbox village for 3 minigames. The PS2 also provides 3 minigames at the Magic Well, once you've purchased all of your powers and upgrades, with only one minigame shared between the two. The PS1, however, has probably the most interesting reward for collecting enough yellow lums. You get to play a working demo of the original 2D Rayman 2. That's awesome!
And that really wraps up the 4 primary versions of Rayman 2. And honestly, the only other thing I can even think to say about them is that the dance that Rayman does at the end of each level goes in the opposite direction on the PS1. That's really just a quirk, so those are the 4 main versions, but we still have a little bit of cleanup to do. And honestly, there's not much to talk about with DS and 3DS ports, as they are direct ports of the N64 and Dreamcast respectively, but there are a few things worth noting.
For example, in Rayman DS, they tried to include touchscreen controls, which, to be honest, are awful, and the regular controls aren't really much better since they've been redesigned with a D-pad in mind rather than an analog stick. And sadly, the other controls don't fare much better, with B jumping and A shooting. Which, funny enough, the manual says it should be the other way around. And it actually says that R is dedicated to diving while swimming, even though it's much more importantly your targeting button. As for Rayman 3D, it's much more successful at bringing the Rayman 2 experience to a handheld. It does drop the glowbox crystals that the Dreamcast had, and it seems that some sound effects are very quiet. But as far as full-fledged Rayman 2 handhelds go, this is the way to go.
And that brings us to Rayman 2 on Game Boy Color, which, like I said, is really its own thing, but it does follow its 3D brethren in theme and story, so it's gotta be in here somewhere.
Rayman 2 Game Boy Color is a 2D side-scroller where, just like the original Rayman, you've got your flying fist as your primary attack. Just like the others, you've got to collect the yellow lums. 800 are available here, just like in the PS1 version, and free teensies from cages, then proceed to the next area. The story plays out in non-animated cutscenes, and it's only here that the other characters are ever represented. When you start collecting the masks, they're just out in the open for you to grab, and then jump into the portal to continue. No guardians, not really any bosses to speak of even. Well, sort of. There are 2 boss fights in the game. The first with a robo-pirate who will drill into the ground and resurface beneath you, which, once you get his pattern down, is super easy. And then there's Razorbeard, who looks like a robo-pirate, and drills into the ground and resurfaces underneath you. Yeah, it's the same fight. But the cutscene leading into it does specifically call him Razorbeard, there just wasn't another fight programmed.
In all, Rayman 2 for the Game Boy Color is a severe oversimplification of The Great Escape, but on its own merits, it's a short, albeit competent, side-scrolling entry into the Rayman franchise. And finally, we can wrap up the story on Rayman 2 in all of its forms, until it gets an HD remake, that is. But where does that leave us? I think it's fair to say that if you need a handheld Rayman 2, Rayman 3D is the star for sure.
If for no other reason than it's made for an analog control. But it's a solid port all around, and with only some small misgivings about the low volume sound effects, I can wholeheartedly recommend.
As for the main 4, that's a tough call. I don't think any of them can be called definitive, as each one has something that the others lack.
I'll happily dunk on the PS1 version for cutting so much content that it's more like a demo. But as for the others, You've got the stunning visuals of the Dreamcast and its amazing frame rate. You've got the sheer amount of content in the PS2 and the rock-solid controls and standards set by the N64.
In cases like this, I can't help but fall back onto which game did I have the most fun with, and for me, that was the Dreamcast. I'm tempted to say the PS2 just for the sheer size of it and added content, but to be honest, for a decent camera, I would gladly give up that hub world and new areas, so I put the Dreamcast at the top of the pile, followed narrowly by the N64 and then the PS2, but they're all up here, and the PS1's a little bit down here, but to be honest, you can't go wrong. Now, if you are looking for more digital options, there's GOG.com for the PC version. The PS1 and PS2 versions are available as PS Classics through the PS3, with the PS1 also being on PSP and Vita, so there's loads of options, which is a very good thing indeed. See you next time.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for sticking around for this long episode, and a special humongous thanks to Nitro Rad, both for your willingness to cameo and your encouragement to do this episode. I'll see you all soon. Till next time.